Bible's Luke chapter 13, verse 32. And the topic for today is the day after tomorrow. And I'll read. He said unto them, that was just right speaking, go ye and tell that fox, behold, I cast out devils, and I do cure today and tomorrow. And the third day I shall be perfected. Amen. I can tell you there's so many things that we need to understand in the scriptures, which are actually a shadow of what we ourselves are going to go through. Just like I said, today I work, tomorrow I work, but on the third day I'll be perfected. Amen. Jesus Christ has already entered his own perfection. Amen. But we are still working towards our perfection. Amen. And also Christians, when the Lord speaks to us in a way, many of us have actually misheard God. Not actually misheard God, but God is saying one thing and we're hearing something different. Amen. And I can tell you this for many reasons. Why men can hear something from God and yet interpret it in a very different way. If you open your Bibles to go to Jeremiah chapter 1 from verse 11 to 12, Jeremiah 1, 11 to 12, the Bible says, the word of the Lord came to me. What do you see, Jeremiah? God showed Jeremiah a thing. And he had to actually act to confirm with Jeremiah what he saw. And Jeremiah said, I see an almond tree. And God said, you have seen well. So it is possible for a man not to see well. It is possible, despite God is making it clear, for a man not to see clearly. Because of your experiences, because of the things you've gone through. Some people will say, I will never serve God because he didn't hear my prayer. He allowed my mom to die. He allowed my father to die. He allowed me to go into this situation. But I'll tell you, God is a faithful God. Why he did that, you might not be able to comprehend it, but you need to know at the back of your mind that all things work together for good for those who love God and are called according to his purpose. Amen. God is saying a word, but many people interpret it the other way. Amen. When God spoke to Jesus Christ, some people say it was the thunder that was speaking. Some people say it was an angel. But only a few people knew that it was God himself. Amen. Some people might not say it's just nature. It's just coincidence. Today's message, I don't want you to see this message as a coincidence. I want you to see it as a direct word of God to you, to your situation. Amen. And I pray that God of heaven will help us in Jesus' name. Amen. And when I went into the scriptures, and I went to look at the references towards the day after tomorrow, there are many references of today after tomorrow. But today we're going to look at just one, we're going to look at three references. Amen. We're going to look at three references that speaks about the day after tomorrow. And remember when I said the day after tomorrow, to make it simplified in our own layman terms or in the common English terms, it means, it means in the third day. Amen. So the first one we're going to look at is, let's open our Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 11. 1 Corinthians 10, 11. The Bible said these things happen to them as examples that and were written down as for us as a warning. Amen. The things we're going to look at today were being done in the past so God can show us something he wants to do in our own lifetime. If you read also the book of Revelation chapter 1 verse 19, Jesus Christ was speaking to John the beloved and he said, write these things down, the things that are, the things that will be, and the things to come. Amen. Let me tell you, God's word never fails. And it will not fail. Amen. It is eternal. People will say, oh, you know, we're in a modern world. God is not a modern God. It will not change. It's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Man might change, God never change. And neither does his standard. Amen. So the things he has said in the past are also the things that are going that are seen to us today. He will not change it because we are now in the 21st century. He won't change it. Because we have cell phones. It will not change it because we have laptops right on our laps. It will change. Its words has ever been and there will be. Amen. So the first character we're going to look at today is about the day after tomorrow. It's from Rehoboam, the experience of Rehoboam. Rehoboam is the son of Solomon, the grandson of David. Amen. So if I just put it that way. The son of Solomon, who is the grandson of David. So David begat Solomon, and Solomon begat Rehoboam. And so when we speak about the day after tomorrow, it's actually a time when people actually do some things. The time when destinies are shaped. So in this context, I want you to see the day after tomorrow as a time when your destiny is formed. Let's read 2 Chronicles chapter 10, verse 5. and verse 19. Second Chronicles, because of our time, I'm not going to read everything. Second Chronicles 10:5 and Second Chronicles 10:19. I read. Rehoboam answered, "Come back to me in 3 days." Come back to some other versions would say, "Come back to me the day after tomorrow." Amen. The people came up to him and said, "Your father was very mean to us. We love your father. Yes, we want to be loyal to him. But your father is very mean to us. We want you to treat us kindly." But he said something. He said, "Come in 3 days and I will answer you. Come the day after tomorrow and I'll give you an answer." And verse 19 says, so the people went away. So Israel, and then verse 19 now. So Israel has been in rebellion against the house of David to this day. It takes 2 days to make a decision that will shape the third day of his destiny. The first day, the first Bible said, when Rehoboam left, he consulted the old men who were with his own father. And they told him that, speak kindly to these people. Tell them you treat them nicely. But also, he also went to the to his friends, to his people, to his colleagues, to people like him. You know, his age mates, the people he grew up with. And they told him, don't listen to him. Don't listen to them. Deal with them harshly. Scare them. Amen. Let me tell you, people always say that two ways, that two things that make people do things for you. Either through fear or through love. But which one do you think works best?
Love.
You can make a child respect you out of fear. You can scare the child to tell him, if you don't do this, I'm going to smack you. Yes, he might do it. But if the child does it out of love, it's much, much stronger and better. Likewise, these people were asking for that we want to be loyal to you. We want you to deal with us. The old man said, deal with them with love. Tell them, show them kindness. But while the young man said, let's show them harshness. Show them that you're not weak. Show them that you can be strong. And that actually formed his destiny forever. God destined that the house of David will rule over all Israel. But the decision of Rehoboam in the first 2 days determined what his destiny was on the third day and forever. Let me tell you, it's true that I'm not saying that in 2 days you're going to make decisions. But in our lifetime, in when we are living at this point, we're making decisions today. Decisions that will affect our destinies forever. Some people have made decisions that they have ruined their womb, that they can never have children. Some people have made decisions that they cannot have, never have a good job in Canada, especially in North America. You have a criminal record, you can say, you can kiss good career, bye-bye. If you've ever been to jail, there might be some pardon, yes, but you can kiss having a job that, you know, you're well paid, and you know, things like that, bye-bye. And that's why they tell people, avoid what you post on social media. You're not sure who's watching it. I remember when, I'm not sure if it was in Canada or in the States, there was a lady, I think she's just 27 or less. She won the election. Yes, it's in Alberta. And that weekend, she was not even in Canada when they were voting. Because they just thought it was a joke. She went to the States, Las Vegas. And on there, she was, you know, showing her pictures of how she was partying. And that was what people were trying to use against her. Amen. Let me tell you, the decisions you make today and tomorrow will affect the day after tomorrow. We affect your third day. Many people are making decisions based on their flesh, based on the young men, based on irrational thoughts. If you look at that, the old men actually symbolize wise counsel. They symbolize objectivity. They symbolize fearless and love for God. While the young men symbolize irrational thoughts, subjectivity, foolishness. You know, let us just do what we think is best. They were not devoted to the things of God. And that was what brought judgment. And I can tell you, every one of us have the young men and the old men sitting on our shoulders.
Yeah.
Every time somebody says something to you, a voice inside of you is telling you, just don't react. Be kind. And another voice is saying, take your stand. You need to show that you are a man. You need to show that you're not just a weakling that you're going to be pushed around. And many of us, and I'll tell you, the voice of the young men are much, much stronger than the voice of the old men. The voice of the Holy Spirit is always very calm. It might just tell you once, but the voice of devil, the voice of the young man, we keep pounding and keep pushing, telling you, just push. Your husband said something, just say something back. Let him know that you have the last words. Let him know that you are the wife in the house. Amen. I pray God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
If you read the book of Jeremiah, Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 19, Deuteronomy 30:19, Moses was speaking. He said, "This day I call the heavens as an account to you. Choose today. Either you want to serve life, you want to take death. You like it or not, there's always decisions before you. Shall I choose life? Shall I choose death?" Rehoboam said, "Come a day after tomorrow, and I'll give you an answer." But in the first 2 days, he consulted with two different people, with two categories of people, the young man and the old man. But he chose the decision of the young man. And that actually destroyed his third day. Amen. Today, all I'm asking you is this. Things will come to your life. You will have to make a decision like Rehoboam. That will have to either make you or mar you. But what decision will you make? Will you take the voice of the Holy Spirit? Or will you take the voice of man? Let me tell you, in everything in life, there's always two ways to it. Always two ways. There might even be more than two ways. There's always two ways to something. Some people will tell you, all you just need to do is work hard and you get that job. And some people will tell you, you don't even have to work hard. Just, you know, manipulate some things to get wealthy. But you can be so sure that the former is better than the latter. The former has a reward at the end. The latter actually has some consequences that comes with it. Amen. Let's open our Bibles to the book of Ezekiel chapter 9, verse 10. Ezekiel 9:10. So whatever your hands plans to do, do it with all your might. For in the realm of the dead where you're going, there's neither walking or planning, nor knowledge, nor wisdom. On that third day, when that decision has been made, you can say some decisions, yes, you have to live with it for the rest of your life. A man commits immorality. He cheats on his wife. Let me tell you, no matter how much he asks his wife for forgiveness, nobody will forget it. The Bible said, whosoever commits adultery, his shame will never be wiped away. Yes, Bill Clinton has been forgiven by his wife. But anytime you remember Bill Clinton, you also remember Monica Lewinsky. No matter how much it's a long time ago. I think it was in the 90s. When did that happen? 90s or 80s?
Late
90s. Late 90s. And yet till today, we're in 2017, we still speak of it. You talk of David, you remember Bathsheba. Amen. They will always, there's some decisions you make in your life that will always affect your destiny. What we're asking you today is, in these your two days, take time. I'm not literally saying 2 days, but in this your lifetime, make decisions that will change your destiny. There will be a time when you can undo them. The Bible said, in the grave where you're going, there's no wisdom, no knowledge, there's no repentance, nothing done there. You can't change it anymore. Now you have the choice to serve either God or take Babel. Choose whom you will serve. And I pray that God of heaven will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let me tell you, we need to go back to the old man, to the old man's counsel. The old man's counsel symbolizes that counsel of God, the old path. Let me tell you, the believers in the Old Testament were called the followers of the way. They were not even called Christians. They were followers of the way, the believers. But today, we call ourselves Christians, and yet we are just like the world. Today, the Bible is saying to us in Proverbs 22, verse 28, it said, do not remove the ancient landmark. That ancient landmark which the patriots walked by, which the apostles walked by, which the believers ahead of us walked by. Let us not move them. Let us stand by them. These people were people who stood by righteousness. They were willing to die for God. But today, you find all kinds of cheats in church. Today, people have to actually, if somebody tells you they want to sell something to you in the church, you better check it properly. Because it might be a scam. And that shouldn't be in the church. But today, that's where we are. I pray God will help us in Jesus' name. Rehoboam rejected the counsel of the old man. And that brought judgment upon him. He chose to take the counsel of the young man, which he grew up with. Yes, we are in this world. We are in this time, in this generation. But let us not do like this generation. Amen. Let us not become like people who are not even sure of what they stand for. Today, your sexuality is no longer based by what we're born as a baby. I actually used the neutral gender washroom about last week. I went to this place, and I went to a place for a meeting, and I saw here the female's washroom, which was clear. On the right side, I saw neutral. I'm like, okay. And you wouldn't believe it, a lady just walked out from that neutral. Now, I was actually afraid because I wasn't sure how many stalls were in there. Is there still another lady in the washroom? Because I walk into the washroom, now I find somebody else there. Amen. But I still had to use it. Amen. I have to use it because there was no option for men. If they had said man, woman, and neutral, that would have been much easier. I would have walked straight to the man's washroom. But there was strictly female and there was neutral gender. Now, tell me, where will I go?
Neutral.
I had to use the neutral. But what I said was, a lady just came out from the neutral. And now,
she was a lady.
Hopefully she's a lady. Like she said, hopefully she's a lady. Mm. Amen. Today, people's sexuality are no longer based on the gender of the sex at birth. Today they say, I can decide what I want. And that's not the old part. The old part is, you are born a boy, you are a boy. You are born a girl, you are a girl. Amen. You want to marry, it is not Adam and Steve. It is Adam and Eve. It's not Eve and Sarah. It is Eve and Adam. Amen. It is not that, oh, I'm a woman, I can decide whatever I want to do in my house. It is the man is over the woman. Like Christ is over the man. Let me tell you, every man that really loves God will treat his wife the way Christ treats the church. Does Christ not treat us well?
He does.
He does. Christ died for us. But this is what we need to ask our husbands and the men in the church. Are you willing to die for your wife? Are you willing to give your wife the best? That's why I like the Igbo culture in Nigeria. There are one people that an Igbo man might be ready to wear a tattered shirt, but his wife will wear the best clothes. That's the way. If you want to know how well an Igbo man is, look at his wife. Well dressed. But there's a group, there's a tribe, ethnic group in Nigeria that is not as that much. The Yoruba group are not that much. Yoruba man might dress and wear the biggest armada, does not care whether his children eat or drink. Amen. And that's why I prefer the Igbo people. They're very loyal to their wives. But they might be, my wife might be, she might give birth to 12 children. But they are very strict. Amen. They're very patriarchal society. Amen. But what I'm trying to say is this, let us love like Christ loved. Amen. Let us go back to the old path. To that standard where God said, imagine in those days, our great grandmothers and mothers stood with our fathers. Will you tell me that our forefathers were not wicked? They were not mean? They were. But our mothers knew that marriage is an institution that I just don't believe anyhow. I will stand by it to the very end. But today people say, for richer or for richer. There's no richer or poorer. In health and in stronger health. I said, you begin to get weak, I'm walking away. I pray God will help us in Jesus' name. Amen. We need to make sure that in our marriages, in our career, we take out that decision that on the third day, that will not marry us. Amen. The Bible said in the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 9, this is where I want to read for every man. And even for every woman. Let me tell you, if marriage, any man that does not have a good wife has lost everything in his life. And any woman that does not have a good man has lost everything. Let's read Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 9. Enjoy life with your wife. Whom you love. The first thing is, make sure whosoever you're marrying must be someone you love. All the days of your meaningless life that God has given you under the sun. For this is your lot in your toilsome labor under the sun. What God tells you is this. Let me tell you, your lot is not your career. Your lot is not even your children. Your lot is your spouse. The consolation God has given to us as husbands and wife is our spouse. For a man, my consolation is my wife. The time I come home, all I just want, as long as my wife says, it is well. Every other person I've said goes out the window. It gives me that peace that it is well. Amen. The times I'm not looking at our bank account anymore. All I'm looking for is just that embrace. Amen. God is saying, make that decision. Make that wise decision. Don't be like a real one who took the 2 days of his life to destroy its third day. Amen. The third day speaks about your destiny. What will you say? What decision will you say you're making today? I pray God will help us in Jesus' name. And also, the second reference to the day after tomorrow that we saw in the Bible is in Exodus chapter 19, verse 10 to 11. Let's open our Bibles to Exodus 19, 10 to 11. The children of Israel were to be visited by God, and God said something to them. He said, and the Lord said to Moses, go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow. Have them wash their clothes and be ready by the third day. Because on that day, the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all people. There's going to be a day of visitation. A day of visitation. But what you do in your first 2 days will determine how God will visit you. Let me tell you, God is always, he wants to come close to us. The Bible said that 6 things the Lord hates, and the seventh is an abomination to him. He will not change it. A haughty eyes, you know, a lying tongue, a proud heart, a feet that is always quick to evil. Something is bad, you're always there. Somebody stole, oh, you're there. Somebody, 2 people are fighting, you're the one there. You're always where something bad is always happening. You need to check your life. Amen. Something's going wrong, you are the one. You need to ask yourself, God, what have I done? A feet that is swift to error. And the seventh one, which the Bible said was a man that brings discord among brothers. Amen. God of heaven wants us to wash ourselves from every impurity so he can visit us. The day of visitation is coming very soon. But how will God find you? Will he find you separated? Will he find you sanctified? Or will he find you in dirt? He said he resists the proud. And what does he do to the humble? He gives grace to him. He grants him grace. Let me tell you, any whatever position you are in war today, there's nothing you have done to merit it. The rich, they just make, I'll tell you, I've worked, before I got married, I worked 2 times harder than what I work now. At one point in my life, I only sleep at home 3 days in 2 weeks. In 14 days, I only sleep on my bed 3 days. I sleep at my other job some few days, I go to another place, work 3 days. And yet, I could not show anything for it. But a time came when even I go home at 5 p.m., at times I don't even take 6 days, I'm free, and yet I can say, God, you have blessed me. It is not by how hard you work. But when God blesses it and breathes upon you what you have worked, you see that it will multiply. Amen. Not by how much you think, oh, I can do. Amen. When I was trying to do it by myself, I couldn't make anything. But when I gave it up to God, God brought everything. Amen. He said, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and every other thing shall be added unto you. In the day of visitation, will God find you holy and sanctified? Or will he find you dirty? The Bible said in the book of Isaiah chapter 59 verse 2, it said, your sins have separated you from God. Your iniquities have made a big gulf between you and God. God is like that pole that stands constant. If you move closer to him, he will move closer to you. If you walk farther from him, he will walk farther from you. Amen. God wants us. He wants to show himself in our lives. Amen. But you know, on that day of visitation, he's asking that in these 2 days, before that day, you need to cleanse, you need to clean yourself. You need to consecrate yourself. Amen. I'll give an example, those 3 examples of people who had a visitation from God. Or rather, we can say that had a visitation. The first one is Abraham. Abraham lived such a life that in Genesis chapter 22 verse 12, God had to say to him that now I know that Abraham loves me beyond all things. Let me tell you, many of us, the heavens are not even so sure why we're still in church. I tell people, if you're going to be a Christian, be a Christian. If you're going to leave the world. Leave and go back into the world. Don't do Christianity and the world. Some people want to dance, what do you call that dance again? They don't do Azonto. And yet they still want to be Christians. Let me tell you, if you want to do Azonto, then go to the club and do Azonto. If you want to be a Christian, be a Christian. I tell people, you want to sing a song, and you tell me, Doro Jesus. And how do you think Doro Jesus is? And they don't even know what Doro means. It's a concept they sing in Nigeria. They're not even sure what it means till today. And yet people sing it, and they want to bring it into church. Because, you know, it feels exciting to the body. Today people want to still do Doro, and yet they still want to do Jesus. If you want to do Doro, take Doro and go to, I don't even know if it's an English word. Take Doro and go to the club. If you want to be a Christian, stand for God. And that's why I like the old Christian songs. We're talking in the car today. The old Christian songs make more meaning. Not the ones we sing today, you're not even sure. They first start off with all the, I tell myself, if you want to sing. I don't want to hear your voice and you harmonizing like a cat or like a dog. Sing, let us bless God, not harmonize. Amen. Bible said, now I know Abraham loves me beyond everything. I'll give you another example. Same example. God came unto Abraham at night. He said, I want you to go sacrifice your son. And Bible said, in the next morning, he did not wait. He woke up. We don't even hear the account of Abraham consulting with his wife. He took his son, took two of his servants, and set out on the journey. And he did not see the place where he was going until the third day. The Bible said, on the third day, then God now showed it to him and showed him the mountain. Let me tell you, God says, go. On the first day, you are walking. You don't even know where you're going. Second day, you are walking. It takes faith for you to do that. Until the third day, before God even showed him where he was going. And he said to the servants, stay here. Me and my son, we go up and worship God. And we'll come back to you again. Because he believed that even if I kill this son, God will give him back to me. Amen. God knew that Abraham. Amen. God help us in Jesus. Amen. Let's pick it up. Amen. Oh yeah, that's good too. Amen. I pray God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So the first person who actually lived a life where you could see that God, that on day of visitation, God said yes and no, was Abraham. Can God say of you that I know that you love God? Can God say of you? Let me tell you that three that bear witness in heaven, and they have to bear witness about you. And there are also three that bear witness on earth, and they have to bear witness about you. If men have not spoken about your faith, then your Christianity is not your peer. Let me tell you this. They knew that Daniel was a righteous man, but they knew that there's nothing that is faulty about him. They could not, that's why they don't like him, but they knew that there's nothing faulty about him. But they knew that he loves his God. Men have to give testimony of your faith. The Christians, the believers, the brothers were first called Christians in Antioch. First, they saw them and they knew that this was Christ-like. I tell people I don't have to go to anywhere and say I'm a Christian. Let people see you and say, this man, you are different. So what do you do? Are you a Christian, Muslim, Jew, whatever you are? Let them see something different about you. Can people look at you and say, now I know that this man really loves God? Can the devils also speak about your faith? The demon that was upon a man said, Jesus, I know. Paul, I know. Your name, I've never heard before. The servants of Sceva, I've never heard of that name before. Who are you? Can the devils testify of your devotion to God? And the third personality that speaks of our faith, can God himself say, now I know. Let me tell you, when Job was tested, the devil came to God and said, does Job not love you just because you've been good to him? And that was why God said, now let's take out everything I've given to Job and let's still see if he still loves me. If you don't have that house, if you don't have that car, if you don't have that money, if you don't have those children, if you don't have everything you think you have today, will you still love God? And the Bible, and the funny thing is this, they said, fire came from heaven and consume all that Job had. Why from heaven? Because otherwise it would make me feel like, God, I'm serving you and you're still killing my stuff. A wind came and it killed everything he had, and yet Job said, you give and you take away. And in all, he did not sin against God. Job. And that was why at the end of his life, God was able to bless him two times more than everything he ever had. Amen. The third person, which was not a very good character, but I just want to put it in, of the day of visitation, is King Asa. Asa was a king that got sick. Let me tell you, there's nothing bad for you to be sick and seek help. But even in your searching of help, let God be paramount. Let's open our Bibles to 2 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 13. 2 Chronicles 16, verse 13. It said, in the 39th year of his reign, Asa was afflicted with a disease in his feet. Though his disease was severe, even in his illness, he did not seek help from the Lord, but only from the physicians. Then in the 41st year of his reign, Asa died and rested with his ancestors. The reason why he lost his life was not because God cannot heal him, but because he depended solely on the physicians and let God. Many of us believe so much on Dr. Phil than God. Many of us believe so much on Oprah than God. They tell you the 10 steps to remain healthy, Dr. Oz. Let me tell you, I've seen people who have never smoked in their life and yet have lung cancer, died of lung cancer. And there are people who smoked all their life, they're chain smokers, and lived up to 85. One of my friend's dad, a chain smoker. As soon as from the time he wakes up to the time he goes to bed, smoking. And he did not die of true cancer. He died a natural death at an old age. Let me tell you, it is not by what you think you can do to yourself. They will tell you, oh, you must eat this in the morning so you can stay healthy. The children of Israel ate the same thing for 40 years. In the morning they ate manna. In the evening they ate quills. 40 years. They only ate 2 times a day. They will tell you, split your meals. Science will tell you, split your meals for 5 meals a day so you can remain healthy. They ate 2 times a day, and yet the Bible said what? None of them were sick, none of them were feeble, they were all strong. Amen. So do you want to tell me that God does not know what he can do? I pray God will help us in Jesus' name. Amen. We need to make sure God, we need to just focus on God. The first 2 days, don't waste time on studying. Let me tell you, people are focused so much on how can I get wealthy. And the one that gives power to make wealth is right beside by your side. And yet you're looking at somebody else. Amen. Like I said, those who are wealthy today, you cannot tell me that there's something they did special that made them wealthy. Honestly. Because I know for a fact that I've not done anything to have what I have. I just go, somebody just tells me, do this. And I just go there, do it, and it just works. I remember in 2009, when the economy crumbled. I had my money in there. You know, I'm the kind of person, I don't even read the papers. They just called me on the phone. They told me, do you want an RSP? I felt, oh, you saved my money. I think I have extra cash. Let me put it somewhere. The guy told me, it's very good for your retirement. By the time you're 50, you'll be able to retire. I said, okay. He told me, do you like being aggressive, medium, or low risk? I told him, what is that word? He said, aggressive, you can make more money quickly. Medium, you're not sure. Low risk, you'll never lose your money, but it might not grow fast. As a young man who I thought I want to help myself, I told the guy, high risk. 2009, I opened my account. I checked my account. Half of my money, gone. I said, okay, maybe let me wait. Maybe tomorrow it will pick up. Checked again tomorrow. Half of what I had yesterday, gone. After that, I called the bank, hey.
Stop.
Put my money back. I'm not doing it again. Amen. But what I just want to say is this. But today, I don't even have RSP. I don't even have all that. And yet, I can say, God, I thank you. Amen. Let me tell you, there are people who seek after man. Let me tell you, the strength of man will fail you. The only thing that can ever fail you is God himself. Amen. Amen. And I pray God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So we've seen the first 2 days. The first day speaks about the day of destiny. The decisions you make in your first 2 days speak about your destiny. How you prepare yourself for the first 2 days shows how God will visit you. And the last one is the day of glorification. That's actually Jesus Christ himself. If you're not going to take anything I've said today, I want you to take this last one. Amen. This is where I want to focus the teaching on itself. Luke chapter 13 verse 32. Today I work, tomorrow I work, the third day I'll be glorified. Let me tell you, as human beings, we are not immortal. We will die one day. If we don't die, Jesus Christ will come. But what will he find in your hand? What you do for the first 2 days will determine how God, either you'll be glorified or you'll be damned. Let me tell you, everybody's going to have eternal life. But where you spend your eternity is what matters. Some people are going to wake up into eternal damnation. Some people are going to wake up into eternal glorification. Will glorification be your portion or will damnation be your portion? I don't want you to answer that question now, but I just want you to know that whatever you do today and whatever you do in your life now, before you pass on, will be what will speak for you. Let's open our Bibles to the book of Mark chapter 8 verse 36. Remember, I've talked about how to make decisions. You might make decisions in your career that might make you well and stable. You might even make decisions that will make everything around you good. But this third decision is what I want you to really think about, the day of glorification. Mark 8:36. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet forfeit his soul? Amen. As Christians, we need to understand that our soul is what is most important, not what we have today. Amen. Every living being on earth, we live in eternity. But what matters most is where you live your eternity. Will you live eternity with God? Or will you live your eternity in the lake of fire? Many people are still afraid of hell. Hell is a place where we'll still be dumped in lake of fire. The Bible said, hell and death will be thrown to where? Lake of fire. So that means there's something even worse than death. There's something worse than hell. Death and hell will be thrown to the lake of fire. And some people will spend their eternity there. Not because God wants them to spend it there, but because the first day and the second day, they have not done anything. They have not worked at all. Amen. Let's open our Bibles to the book of John chapter 5, verse 28 to 29. Do not be amazed as this, for a time is coming when all who are in the graves will hear his voice, that's the voice of God, Jesus Christ, and come out. Those who have done what is good will rise to live, and those who have done what is evil will rise to be condemned. Amen. I pray we'll not be condemned in Jesus' name. Amen. I don't think you're too small. Don't think, oh, I'm too young. Many people think that all children that die go straight to heaven. It is not in the Bible. It's not scriptural. The Bible said, a wicked man from his mother's womb has been wicked. He just trying to come out and do what? Continue his wickedness. Amen. And we're going to study that properly in Bible study. Amen. But I can tell you what matters most is what, how you relate to it. We have always, see, every man has made the decision to serve God even before he was born. But we are actually just coming out to just do it. Ask yourself, why is it that when you hear the things about God, it brings you to him? Something inside of you always longs for God. Mm-hmm. While some people, hearing about God makes them, you want to kill, you. If you go to a gathering and you want to ruin the party for everybody, start speaking about God. You see how many people walk away. As soon as you start talking about God, everybody will walk away. But go to work on Monday morning and tell them how you drank, how you got wasted, that you don't even know where you were. Some of them will come to work and tell and say, oh, I got so wasted yesterday, I don't know how I got home. I'm like, I still did that last week, are you going to do it again? And they're actually proud to tell you such things. But you tell them that, oh, we went to church and we start talking, you see everybody in the coffee room start walking out. Nobody wants to hear about God. But those who want to be Christians, let me tell you, as soon as you hear about God, it pulls them to you. Amen. I pray God will help us in Jesus' name. Let me say in the book of Revelation, chapter 20, verse 12. He said, and I saw the dead, great and small. Old man, young man. You think that only old people are going to go to hell? No. Young people are going to go to hell too. Amen. God help us in Jesus' name. I know many people are actually, no. And the issue is this. Let me tell you, it is not in our place to tell. That's why when people say, when somebody dies, they say, oh, he's resting with the Lord right now. I don't want to say that. Because only the Lord knows who I is. There are so many people that on that day there will be so many surprises. You will walk to the heaven and you'll find so many people in hell. How did he get here? Oh, he had a secret sin in his life. Amen. But everyone that will get to heaven is sure. Just that the surprise is that the people you thought you would find in heaven, you'll find them in hell. The ones that you thought you would find in hell, you'll find them in hell. So when people say, oh, there's some people you think they're going to go to hell. If people already think you're going to hell, then you're going to hell. Because that means there's something in your life that is not godly. Because if people think I'm going to hell, then that means I've done something wrong that people are actually thinking. Because if the church money gets embezzled and you hear that all the women that come to church, all of them say, oh, I was pregnant with the pastor. Do you think I'm going to heaven? Straight to hell. Straight express road. Amen. But there's many people, many of us think, so many pastors. I heard of this testimony. It's actually a testimony. It's actually a shame to the body of Christ. There was a gathering of over 1 million people in Nigeria. And somebody gave a ride to a very old man who was heading back to his destination. And the man said, oh, can't you see over 100,000 people give their life to Christ? And things like that. And there were over 1,000 pastors present in that gathering. Over 1,000 pastors were present. And the old man that was picked up said, that in this gathering, only, was it 10,000? I don't remember the number. Only 1,000 were redeemable at that time. If Christ had come at that time, I think 100. Let's just say 1,000. Only 1,000 is rapturable. Now tell me, 100,000 people came out and said, I want to give my life to Christ. Over 1 million people were present. Over 1,000 pastors present. Then tell me, who are those going to heaven right there? There are many pastors you assume are going to heaven. They're going straight to hell. The Bible said in the book of James, said, those who are teachers will be more what? Will be more strictly judged. And this is where many pastors are going to go to hell. They show you the way, they themselves are not going. They're like signboards. Way to heaven. Does that signboard go to heaven? It's just standing there. They're telling you where to go. But many of them are not going anywhere. I pray God will help us in Jesus' name. Amen. How you live your today, how you live tomorrow, will show where you live, where you'll be at the end. Jesus Christ said, today I kill people. I cast out demons. On the third day I'll be glorified. What will you say you have done that will bring glorification to you? Amen. You like it or not, we'll all be judged. 2 Corinthians 5 verse 10. 2 Corinthians 5 10. Each and every one of us will be judged. Some life, some death. And if you ask yourself, maybe this is just for those who are around us or people on the online that might be watching this later. How can I work my first 2 days to ensure that I'll be glorified on the first day, on the third day? How do I work my first 2 days to make sure that on the third day I will sit with the Lord, saying, enter my rest, my faithful servant? The first thing you need to do is this. You need to come to the Lord and accept him as your Lord and Savior. John chapter 1 verse 12. He said, as many that came to him, he gave them power to do what? To be what? To be sons of God. You want to be a child of God. You want to be a son of God. You must come to Christ and acknowledge him. The Bible said in the book of Romans, it said, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, you are saved. Amen. Salvation does not, you don't have to go to anywhere. You are saved. You just need to ask God, God, into my life. And that's why I like that song. Into my life, into my life, into my heart. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come in to stay, come into today. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Nobody knows what was going on right now. My wife was the one telling me the words and I was just singing the songs. Amen. Because I had forgotten the songs. Amen. The second thing you need to do is you must be willing to go by the leading of the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you, don't do what I tell you to do. Do what the Holy Spirit is telling you to do. Many people are living their lives based on man's word. Today we have so many churches in the world because many pastors have different ideas of how you can relate to God. Some believe that if your prayer must be 3 hours a day, you must kill all the devils. Some believe that, all we just need to do is praise God. Some believe that, all we need is to know the word. But let me tell you, you need to give your life to the leading of the Holy Spirit. I'll tell you, every single thing I believe as a Christian, I hold on to them by the conviction I have by the Holy Spirit. I don't go by what anyone says. If you notice, I don't keep my beard and stuff. It's because of something I have. I deliberately, I'm not saying that it's wrong. No, don't, you know. But you know, when I first became a Christian, I used to have curly hair. I used to have Jerry curls on my head. When I became a Christian, and I used to wear blings, chains, everywhere, jewels. So I got to the barber one day, and he asked me, because he knows I take care of my hair. He said, how do you want this Saturday? I said, Korean bono, which means shave it. He said, really? Because he knows the intense work I put into it. But I know, I read in the Bible, the Bible said, do not cut the side of your head or clip the edge of your beard. Mm-hmm. Amen. And I told myself, God, I want to live like you. I want to live like what your word says. And I said, take it off, all the coils. But you see some pastors, some of them have Jerry coils on their head. And some of them even have dreads. Amen. It's not my place to condemn any other servant of God. Amen. That's not what I'm doing. Because the Bible says we are all servants of God. So I don't condemn them. I will relate to God as he has revealed it to me. How he has revealed to me, that's how I will walk with him. Amen. Even for myself and my wife, we still have some differences in our faith. Despite we sleep on the same bed. She knows we have some things I believe strongly. Some of us believe that fasting, no water. Some people will tell you, fasting can drink a little bit of water, you know. I can take green tea in the morning. Green tea, no milk, no sugar, you know. Just green tea. I think, to me, I'm already thinking that the green tea is already food. Amen. We all have differences in that. But let me tell you, all I'm asking you to do today is live by the leading of the Holy Spirit. Let your life be led by God. The Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 8 verse 14, as many that are led by the Spirit of God are the what? The sons of God. Not that it's me that come to church. Not that it's me that listen to Pastor Abayomi. That the sons of God, but as men that are led by the Spirit of God, let the Spirit of God lead you in the way you act, in the way you talk, in the way you eat, in the way you dress. Let God be what is there for you. Amen. I tell people, those people that you see, they come out and they will, when they get out, that's when they will be pulling their skirts down. I tell them, so you don't know that this skirt was short when you left the house, Abi, but you now get here, you now be saying, and you can't pick anything on the floor. You now be looking for how to pick the pen that fell. But when you left the house, you knew that you wanted men to see your legs. Now you get here, you're not ashamed. You're not trying to pull it a little bit down. God is always there for many of us, but many of us are not willing to hear him. Amen. May God help us in Jesus' name. Amen. And the last one is how to walk our 2 days to make sure we'll be glorified. Let us walk our salvation with fear and trembling. Walk out your salvation. You can't save yourself, yes. But God has saved you. Then let that light, which is inside of you, let it come out. Let people see the good light in you and let them glorify your Father in heaven. Philippians chapter 2 verse 12. Say, walk out your salvation with fear and trembling. Amen. As Christians, let people see us. I'm not asking you to do anything. Let me tell you, there's nothing I do that will make me more righteous. I cannot be more righteous. I cannot be more, you know. But God wants us to sanctify ourselves. If you read the book of Colossians chapter 3 verse 5 and Colossians chapter 3 verse 8, it said, get rid of these things. Anger. There are things that some of us still do. Anger. Let's open our Bibles to Colossians 3. Quickly, then we'll close. I've already spent more than enough time here. Colossians 3, I'll read verse 5 and verse 8. Colossians 3. The first one, this should not be heard among us. 3:5. Things that should not be heard among us as Christians. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to the earthly nature. Sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Amen. Such things should be far from every Christian. But now let's look at the things that even as Christians, we are taking out of our lives. Every day, we take them out every day. Every day you try to tell yourself, I want to be more kind than yesterday. I want to be less angry than yesterday. I want to be a man who is submissive to God. Verse 8. He said, but now, you must rid yourself of such things. Anger, rage, malice, slander, filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to one another, since you have taken off your old self with these practices. Amen. Amen. We need to walk away from these things every day. Yes, you are a Christian, but live a life where you are free from hunger. You are free from malice. Let me tell you, people will always sin against you. People will always do something to make you angry. But it is now your own part to say, God, help me, O Lord. Don't get angry on the highway. There was one that I'll give another example. Whenever I get into the highway or anything like that, I always tell everyone, thank you. You know, I want someone to be very appreciative. So one day, and thankfully, most people that I also allowed to go in on my road always tell me thank you too. One day, I was driving and I slowed down for this guy and got it. And something inside of me was waiting for him to wave, to say thank you, and he did not. And as soon as that happened, I told myself, you are going beyond your boundaries. I had to start checking myself. Because let me tell you, Bible said, if you reward is only once. Is it like you get it here on earth, or you get it in heaven? That's why whenever I do anything, I don't want anyone to know. Bible said, well, if you're right, whatever your right hand does, don't let your left hand to know. I don't want anyone to tell me thank you. Because I want God to tell me thank you. I don't want your own thank you. So people have already received their reward here on earth. You know, the best pastor for the year. Perhaps in heaven you'll be getting the worst one. But what I'm saying is this, let your life be pure. Don't wait for people's approval. Amen. And I can tell that day, as soon as that thought came to my heart, that this man did not say thank you. And I told myself, henceforth, if I give anybody away, I'm not going to look to see if they said thank you or not. So today, as soon as I let somebody in, I just try to look the other way. So now, because I don't want that to consume me. Amen. And some people get angry that, oh, I did something for him, he did not tell me thank you. Let me tell you, he said, give bread to the eater and say to the sower. The ability for you to be able to do what you are doing today, it's God. You might think that, oh, I bought something for someone. The left of there are people who wish they could buy something for someone, but don't even have the ability to. So why do you think you should be asking people to thank you in any way? I pray God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The last thing is we need to work out our salvation. You need to ask yourself, what is that imputing in me? Paul said in the book of 1 Corinthians 9, verse 27, said, I put my body to subjection that I will not be disqualified after I preach to other people. I've told you not to cheat. Then I should not even think about cheating. I've told you not to, I preach here that we should not lie. Then it should not even come to my mind. Let me tell you, there's a level you get to, God is not only judging what you're doing on the outward, it's judging your intent, your mind. He said, he said, God will judge the intent of man. Many Christians will not commit sexual immorality on the surface. But as soon as they in their mind, they have committed sexual immorality with all the women in the church. Amen. I remember when I first gave my life to Christ, and myself and my younger brother, we went to minister at the place for the house fellowship. A lady sat in the front, very short skirt. I'm not too sure if she had anything underneath. Honestly, that was worst Bible study, worst house fellowship I went to. Because I was home ministering, and my brother could tell. Because normally, I know all the passages I want to talk about. But that day, I was not talking about how Goliath killed David. Because I was trying to, I don't believe it, she became the only thing in that room. Because if I look this way, she's there. She's not actually, but that's my eyes, that's what my eyes is just saying. So I actually had to finish the Bible study quickly. Because before I run mad, and I told my brother, this aspiration I'm not going anymore. This one that the woman will not wear anything good. I'm not doing it anymore. Amen. Let me tell you, we are not superhumans. Run away from sin. The Bible told us to stand against the devil. But when it comes to sin, what do? Run away from sin. Don't even stand. I pray God help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. I pray God will help us. Amen.
Amen.
We need to, as Christians, make sure our life is pure. These 2 days, give your life to Him. Not literally these 2 days. In your lifetime, before that day of glorification, give your life to Him. Be led by the Spirit and let your life be show forth Christ. In your thought, Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. I always tell people, if your thought does not pass this 8 test, then you are failed. It said, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is of honor, whatever people can hear you think and say it is a good thing, think on these things. If people will hear your thoughts and say, ew, then you need to stop it. When we first got married, myself and my wife, you know, I want to say nice things to my wife. Because, you know, I want to make her feel like she's the woman. One day I said something, she said, how about if people hear you saying things like this? What would they say? The pastor, you're saying things. Then I was not even a pastor. You know, because, you know, I was trying to say, hey, you look very beautiful and, you know, let us leave those sides. But she actually said, how about if they hear you say this? But, you know, things like that. And the Bible is saying us, telling us, what's your thought life? Amen. Let your words be seasoned with salt. Whatever you do, either eating, drinking, let it glorify God. Amen. And today I'm asking you to please take that offer. Romans chapter 13, verse 11. He said, our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. Let me tell you, the day of the Lord is coming fast. You might not understand why we're saying it's coming fast, but it's coming. Amen. How will He meet you? I pray God will help us in Jesus' name. I just want to just bow our heads. The Bible says in the book of John chapter 9 verse 4, say, as long as it is day, we must do the work of Him that has sent us. Night is coming when no man can work. Today, I just want to just tell God, God, grant me the grace of God. The grace to consecrate myself in these 2 days. The grace to take the right decision in these 2 days. The grace to do the work of Him who has sent me in these 2 days. Give unto me, O God, that my third day will be glorified. That I will receive a visitation from God on my third day. That I will receive, oh God, a destiny-changing thing in my life, Lord, in Jesus' name. I just want to just bring a comment to God.